All you web developers out there, follow me as I go to the other side of the world to talk to some graphics experts about the insides of modern browsers today. Hi, I'm Alex Danilo. I'm here in Winchester, the home of the famous Round Table. Now, King Arthur may have long gone, but we're bringing a whole lot of graphic experts from all around the world to talk about the web. So welcome to the Graphical Web. Hi, I'm here with Cameron McCormack from Mozilla, and he's working on Firefox. And today he gave a presentation about colourful fonts in OpenType that are available in modern browsers. Cameron, there are three proposals. There's one from Microsoft, one from Google, one from Mozilla and Adobe working together. The main one I found interesting was SVG in OpenType. So can you tell me what the advantage of that is versus, say, one of the other proposals?
Sure thing, Alex. So to summarise the three different proposals, one was a bitmap format that gets embedded into the font, so they're PNGs. That was the Google proposal. A proposal from Microsoft, which had composed glyphs from plain, flat shapes, so regular OpenType glyphs. And the third proposal from Mozilla and Adobe was to embed SVG documents into the font. So with the SVG proposal, you can use the full graphics complexity of SVG to render your glyphs. So that means you can have patterns in the fills, you can use gradients, animation on the glyphs as well.
Right, great. Also, I've seen in Japan quite a lot of people like using emojis like smileys and things like that. So is this what this is aimed at?
Yeah, partially, yeah. So I think a lot of the resurgence in interest in chromatic fonts, chromatic type, has been emoji, which was sort of popularised recently by iOS, but of course now supported across mobile and desktop operating systems. So emoji, since they're little icons, they probably have slightly different requirements from multicoloured lettering. So you might want to choose a bitmap format for those versus a complex vector format, but on the other hand, the bitmaps are not going to scale particularly well, so I think there are pros and cons for both of them.
Right, I get you. And also, I've noticed like web developers always struggle with different kinds of devices, like with a different resolution screen. So to me, I think the SVG proposal is a really good approach towards that. In fact, the Microsoft one's quite interesting too. So what are your thoughts on the tons of pings like in the Google proposal? I mean, don't say anything bad, though.
Yeah, well, so obviously for screens with different DPIs and just for showing the glyphs at different sizes, the scalable proposals have a definite advantage there to avoid pixelation. There's probably a speed difference, whereas with the SVG proposal, you need a whole sort of SVG renderer. Might be a bit slower than the existing OpenType rendering for glyphs with the Microsoft proposal uses, and pings are probably pretty fast to render as well. So for fidelity, I would still probably go for one of the scalable solutions, yeah.
Okay, great. So web developers, look forward to the scalable graphics in your fonts. They're here now in Firefox. They'll be coming to other modern browsers very soon, I'd expect. So looking forward to a colourful future. Hi, I'm standing here with Neil Trevett, who's president of the Khronos Group. Khronos, of course, is the standards body that produces things like OpenGL, WebGL, OpenCL, WebCL, etc. And of course, we all know WebGL is currently in browsers. So, Neil, where do you see the future of hardware acceleration on the web and graphics in general?
I think there's a great future for it, and I think it's going to be at two levels. I mean, we have to remember that all the browser vendors are using GPUs under the covers, the composition, the rendering. But I think your question is talking about the APIs that developers can use themselves. And WebGL, as you say, is now very pervasive. We're expecting it to be everywhere on desktop and mobile. And we hope the next one will be WebCL, which is for compute as opposed to graphics.
Right. I've also seen that the trend in tablets these days is much higher resolution screens. So do you see that trend continuing? Do you think that this would mean silicon is like much more important as we go forward?
Yeah, it's already been a tremendous increase in the number of pixels that have to be processed. From the original iPhone to the iPad mini, it's a 20 times increase in the number of pixels. That's an enormous number of pixels to process and to push around in the system. And if you have to do that on the CPU, not only is it going to be not snappy and buttery smooth on the screen, it's going to eat your battery. So there's a double win for bringing this rendering off the CPU onto the GPU. It goes faster and your battery will last longer.
Right. And so for the web developers out there, like if they were going to get started with WebGL, what would you recommend they do? Do they learn raw WebGL? Do they jump in one of the JavaScript libraries? Or what would you think they should do?
If they're already a 3D developer and they know OpenGL ES, they'll find WebGL very familiar and it'll be very easy to come up the learning curve. If you're coming into it fresh, I would start with one of the proven middleware libraries because they can really ease the learning curve. Now, 3D.js is one of the easiest. There's a new one, Babylon.js. And actually, there's a bunch of them out there. And depending on what kind of application you're trying to do, sometimes you'll find ones that are targeted just to your kind of community. So Google around, find the middleware library that best suits your needs. The default perhaps is 3.js, and start with there. You'll probably find you can get a long way before you need to start figuring out more details.
Okay, wonderful. Thanks very much for that insight, and we're looking forward to a great hardware accelerated future on the web.
Yes.
Now, Brian and I have been working together on the web animation spec, which I'm really excited about. So I just wanted to ask Brian, what do you see that web animations does for the general web developer?
Yeah, it probably does about two things. I guess, first of all, it gives developers access to the animation functionality of the browser. So the browser can do optimizations that you can't do in JavaScript, such as running things on another thread. And so it gives developers access to that, but also lets developers peek into what the browser's doing with their regular CSS animations and so on. So they can inspect why the CSS isn't working, and they can also tweak it as well and extend it in ways they couldn't do otherwise. And also, I guess, in addition to that, it explains what's going on. We have CSS and we've got SVG, and this is a common model that explains what both of those are doing so that developers can make the transition between different technologies as they need to.
Right. Yeah, so we already have smile animation, right, in SVG, and we have CSS animations and transitions. So what actually happens with web animations? Does it bring the model together, or are they incompatible? How does it actually work under the hood?
Yeah, so basically we've tried to work out what are the common features between the two and base the model around that. So it's feature complete with regards to everything in both CSS and SVG. It's the union of those two. And then we aim to just layer CSS and SVG as kind of syntactical layers on top of that. So it's really just a one unified model for both of them.
Right, okay, great. Now, I know that Chrome's actually implemented web animations, and we've seen some really great performance improvements on demos. So are we going to see this in Firefox anytime soon?
Yeah, I'm working on it. So bits have already landed in Nightly, and it's coming along. We're focusing on a different subset to Chrome initially, but yeah, we're definitely having sites the same subset that Chrome's already released. So yeah, you can expect that someday soon.
Right, cool. Okay, so let me just ask you, what about other browsers? Do you think it'll come to other browsers?
I hope so. I really hope so. And I think in the interim we can use a polyfill to work around that, and all that'll mean is we won't get quite the same performance. But I think there's a lot of good reasons for browsers to implement that, both in terms of exposing animations through their dev tools, but also just in order to keep up with the performance that they'll be seeing in Chrome and Firefox.
Awesome. Oh, well, get started on web animations today. It's usable, it's native in Chrome, it's coming in Firefox. Soon every browser should have it, fingers crossed. And give it a go. This year's conference, Frank, there's been a lot of focus on hardware accelerated approaches to web performance and web graphics. So Internet Explorer 9, 10, 11 have really embraced hardware acceleration. So one of the things you spoke about was how IE breaks up the layers in a web page and then uses the underlying OS to do the compositing. Can you talk a little bit about how that works?
Sure. So we have a OS compositor that we use that renders all of the IE content. It's a very nice way for us to make the browser very, very fast and enable some key scenarios like SVG filter, hardware acceleration, for example. So there's a nice way for us to, starting with IE9 and IE10, set the scene for building a nice and fast, touch-friendly mobile browser.
All right, excellent. And another feature that I thought was really interesting was that currently the IE11 actually enables YCBCR JPEG support, so it actually sends YCBCR to the GPU instead of RGB data. Now, that is aimed at reducing memory bandwidth. So how does a web developer actually use that feature?
So it's actually very simple. All you need to do in Photoshop is, when you do file save as JPEG, is just set the compression to between 0 and 50, and that'll do that setting. Or there's also a tool called Riot, Radical Image Optimization Tool, and that can do the subsampling for you as well.
Right, excellent. And also, we all know the multi-screen world is here, mobile phones, tablets, and desktops and everything. So, like, how does IU address it as far as a compatibility feature thing, like across the different devices? How does that work?
So, like other browsers, I think, we have a very big interest in keeping the web platform the same across all devices. So we run the same code across all devices. When we did WebGL, we did it on the desktop first, and we compiled it for mobile in one afternoon. So it's the same code running in the same place.
Okay, brilliant. All right, well, lovely to hear about it. There you go, web developers. Shrink your JPEGs using the YCBCR. It'll save you space on your site. It'll run faster as a result and work beautifully in all browsers. Now, Erik, like, there's a lot of graphics that's been happening in this conference. There's SVG and there's Canvas and there's WebGL. I understand you're the chair of the SVG working group. So where would you use, as a web developer, where would you use SVG as opposed to, say, Canvas, and what are the advantages of it?
So, I mean, one of the main use cases we see right now is icons and scalable vector resources for websites, for icons, for imagery that's meant to be panned and zoomed. This is one use case that SVG is supremely suited for as an image format, which Canvas isn't, right? The other thing, I guess, is smaller interactive web applications, like, say you have a seating for theater or something like that, you have a seating plan and you want to be able to pick some seats, you need to know where seats are, and it's easy if it's available in the document itself. You just add event listeners as you would in HTML. So for applications that aren't that complicated with a relatively low number of elements, that's a good use case for SVG. Whereas if you have graphics that require you to draw a lot of elements, so you have billions of rectangles or points, then Canvas is much more suitable for that. So,
okay, that makes sense. And also, like, I know the SVG working group's been working hard on SVG 2. So as people, web developers have now become accustomed to SVG 1, which is in all the browsers, but SVG 2 is coming. So can you tell us roughly what SVG 2 brings to the table?
So SVG 2 is continuing the work we did with SVG 1.1 second edition, which is basically trying to smooth over all of the gaps between HTML and CSS and SVG. So making the platform a bit more consistent, dropping certain things that we had in 1.1 which no longer apply. Like, we had interfaces, for example, for pausing the rendering to be able to update lots of elements in the DOM tree. Turns out browsers these days optimize for this anyway, so those interfaces don't apply. They don't do anything useful anymore. So we could remove those, and it's cleanups like that. And we're also trying to promote more of the existing attributes to properties, so that you can style like the width of a rectangle with CSS, which makes doing certain things easier.
Right. Okay. And do you ever see SVG being hardware accelerated in Blink?
Yes, I think that's the way of the future. I mean, it's always going to have some parts like a fallback in software anyway, but certain things, it's coming, it's going to be there.
Yeah, so this seems to be a recurring theme at the conference, hardware acceleration for everything, especially mobile. Well, there you have it. That was the Graphical Web, and these guys are building better and better browsers just for you.